Are you expect? Yes, shout, clap your hands, and let's receive Bishop to bless us.
Hallelujah. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for the blessing that is ours. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. Elements of the invasion. Elements of the invasion. Because we are invading new territories. And so, what are the elements of the invaders and the invasion? Amen. Number one, these are the elements and the characteristics which we are going to have to develop. Amen.
Amen.
If we are truly going to take the cities and the lands God wants us to take, these are the characteristics, elements, features that we're going to need to have as we possess the land. Number one, the rise of nation-like churches.
Amen.
The rise of nation-like churches. Churches which on their own are like nations. Churches whose size are like the size of a country. Our church in Ghana can make a difference in the elections. Only our church. Only our church can make a difference in the elections. In Ghana, nation-like churches. Churches that are nations. Amen.
Amen.
Are you listening?
Yes.
What I'm saying is in the Bible. Isaiah chapter 2. Verse 2. What does verse 1 say? The word that the prophet saw. And it shall come to pass in the last days that the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains. Amen.
Amen.
And shall be exalted above the hills. Amen.
Amen.
And all nations shall flow unto it. And many people shall go and say, come ye and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob. He will teach us of his ways and we will walk in his paths. For out of Zion shall go forth the law and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. Amen.
Amen.
Are you there?
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Micah 4, verse 1. In the last days, It shall come to pass that the mountain of the house of the Lord shall be established in the top of the mountain. So he's describing the house of the Lord as a mountain. So even mountain-like churches, hallelujah, are going to come in the last days. So if we are going to possess the cities of Canada for Jesus, we need mountain-like churches. Churches you can't miss. When you pass by, you can't avoid seeing. It's like these mountains here. You can't ignore them. And many nations shall come and say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways. We will walk in his paths, for the Lord shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And he shall judge among many people and rebuke strong nations afar off. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation shall not lift up a sword against nation, neither shall they learn war any more. Amen. So you can see here that the church will be so strong that it will rebuke strong nations afar off. You say, hey! The church will be so strong to tell America, hey, shh. Nation-like churches that can talk to other nations and speak to the nations and say, stop it. And they shall beat their swords into plowshares. And nations shall not lift up a sword against nations. Churches which are like nations, which when they speak, nations will listen. Many nations don't listen when the church speaks. When the church speaks, they just ignore and carry on whatever they are doing. But nation-like churches are going to arise. Mighty churches. Yes, big churches. Yes, churches you cannot ignore. Yes, churches you cannot set aside. Yes, pastors you cannot set aside. Yes. Now, the Catholic Church is a nation-like church. It's the only church whose pastor sermons are reported on CNN. Yes. If the pastor of the Catholic Church speaks, CNN and BBC report it. When they have a belief, it's reported on CNN and BBC because it's a nation-like church. And it's a nation within a nation. They have their own little army and their own state and their own everything. Their own bank. Yes. And their own properties. And their own money. Yes. Nation-like churches. And this is the church age. This is the prophecy. It says the mountain of the house of the Lord. That is, the house of the Lord is a mountain. Will be on top of mountains. So, it's not just that the church will be like a mountain, but among mountains, it will be on top of the mountains. Amen. This is the age where God is working through the church. And so, your best bet is to join in to build nation-like churches. Amen. 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 Are you with me?
Yes.
So if we are going to take Canada, we need nation-like churches. You see, where the nation is represented in every city. You can't be 20 people in one corner of Toronto and say that you are a nation-like church. It's not a nation-like church. It's an immigrant fellowship. It's an immigrant club. Fellowship of lonely Africans who have come from whatever and are trying to have some socializing together. It's true. And many times our churches look like that. But today marks the beginning of nation-like churches. And you know why we don't have nation-like churches? It's because pastors are not serious. Yes. You know, over the years, I've been a pastor over the years. And what I've found is, you know, when you send somebody somewhere, you know, the person says things about the country that he sent you to. You get it? So you start to form an opinion or an impression. You know? And you know, everybody speaks in his own way and describes things in a certain way. But over the years, I've come to the conclusion that if you change the pastor or a certain person becomes a pastor in a certain city or country, the church will change, no matter what has been said about that country. Yeah. And I can mention 10 countries and 10 churches where it was said that this is a no-go country. Things are not working there. Things cannot work, blah, blah, blah. Nobody's interested in the church and so on. Then we change the pastor. And when we change the pastor, usually these are full-time missions. When the pastor changed, all right, the church changed. And then we all sat back in amazement and said, ah, is it not this place? That they say that it cannot work. Yes. I sent a missionary once to a certain country. He was there for like 3 years. When he was leaving, there was not even one person to see him off at the airport. Yes. And he was like, this is a country that does not want God. So I made a change and I sent one of my younger first love people there. When he went there, I can show you pictures on my phone of the church now. There was nothing. And this same fellow, I sent him to another church where he was now under a pastor who has already been building a church. So the pastor asked him, go here, go for this prayer meeting, go and do this. And he didn't want to go and he didn't go. So the report rather the pastor brought me, which was again to my amazement, was that the guy is lazy. Yes, but you see, we rather have the impression that, oh, this country, they don't like church at all. I don't want to go into details because if I go into details, it's like I'll be giving away the identity of the country. And the country's name begins with one of the alphabets. Yes. It's like the church cannot work and it is not working and will not work. But I can show you pictures on my phone. It's working. Members. One of the members of the church, the parents of one of them came from a far place to come to see the church which has been able to change her son. Yes. So, we now found out that. So, I told this full-time minister, go and find a job. Go and find a job. And you see, he found it difficult to find a job. Because lazy people can't get jobs. It's true. Lazy people don't get jobs easily. You send somebody else to the same place, the person will get a job. You send a certain type of person, he will give you cock and bull stories. Cock and bull stories. Yes. True. I sent a pastor somewhere and I asked him to focus on the church. He was not even communicating. People don't communicate for various reasons. Sometimes they are doing bad things, so they don't want to communicate. Sometimes they are not achieving anything, so there's nothing to say. So they don't communicate. But whatever the case, the silence and the absence of communication is always 100% a bad sign. Something is not correct. Yes. So I always watch people. It's one of the early symptoms. People who don't communicate. Yes, they don't communicate. Watch out for people who don't communicate. Yes. Huh? Yeah. Anyway, when you ask him, how many members do you have? 12. How many members do you have? 20. How many members do you have? 4. So eventually, I said, you know, move from there. Yes. And I sent somebody else to the same country, started a church, and within a few weeks, he was reporting over 100 people. Yes. You see, but this fellow, the second person, when he was working in the secular world, he worked very well. And he was a high achiever. In fact, when he was even resigning from his work to come full time, the top person asked him to work secretly for the organization. And he called me to ask me. I said, yes, say yes, you do it. Yes. And said, you pay him. I'll pay you. Even as you're going. And I'll support you to go. So I'll pay you. It's a big, very big, big organization. Multi-million-dollar organization. You see over and over and over and over again, it is the pastor. Including Canada. Any church that is not working is the pastor there. If I bring somebody here, but you see, with lay churches, we don't easily transfer or move people because you are there by reason of your job. You are not a missionary. You are an economic migrant. Yes. You see, the truth is better than a lie. Yes. And even if it doesn't sound wonderful, it sets you free when you embrace it and takes you ahead far faster than a lie and deception. Yes. Are you still around?
Yes.
I don't care if you are not around. I'm still here. So, you find that if you are to change the pastor, you'll be shocked at the church. Now, you see here in Canada, it's like, oh, this is, you know, Toronto, this, that, and so on. You know, you cannot, whatever. But is it not this Canada that I saw a pastor from Ghana, his church members have bought a plane? Is it not this country? I was wondering, is it not Toronto? Toronto, yeah. I bought a plane. They bought a plane for the pastor. Yeah. Aeroplane plane. Aeroplane plane. An aeroplane plane. And you see the people in Toronto making excuses and saying how the church does not really work, this and this and that and that. But you still find somebody is able to come there in the same place where you say it's not working. And yes, also from Ghana.
That's right.
And have a church where they are able to buy an aeroplane.
Wow.
Yes. Now, you have to be told Galatians 6:6. That is your prophet. And that is your pastor. It is your duty to honor. You have to be even taught it. And said, it has to be said. For it to even occur to you. That's if you even do. It's true. Whereas people are buying aeroplanes. People who haven't written any book for you to use. That you read, you preach from, listen to podcasts, receiving the word. Galatians 6:6. He that receives the word, let him sow into him that teacheth in all good things. So it is the pastor. So if we are not seeing nation-like churches, I can only say the pastor in question is the cause of the absence of nation-like churches in Canada. I sent somebody to a certain part of this same Canada, and I never heard of him again. Yes, never heard of him again. But recently, I met a pastor who is from the same town that I sent, and apparently is one of the most prominent pastors in the whole of Canada. And that's the town. I don't even know that town. You see, it's the person. Now, you must make sure you are not a technological dead end or a spiritual dead end when it comes to the ministry. Do you know what is a technological dead end? I will explain it to you. You see, there are some things you can no longer apply technology to. It cannot change. There are some things you can apply technology to, like preaching. You can use a microphone. Even this, I can upgrade or change to another type of microphone. I can put technology into, put on TV. I can, even our crusade, we can have technology, the equipment we use, the stage, the hydraulics, many things. We have put so much technology into the crusade. It changes everything. You can add technology to many things. But there are some things you can't add technology to, like harvesting of strawberries. You need to pick it one by one like this from the tree. And there is no technology that can pluck these delicate strawberries. So it's a technological dead end. No further technology can be added to that activity. And there are some pastors who are both technological and spiritual dead ends. Nothing can be added to them or be introduced to them to improve the output. God forbid. Dead ends. It's a dead end. No further. You can't improve in any way. But I say, I hope that you are not a dead end. Alex, are you a dead end? No. God forbid. God forbid. You cannot be a dead end at this stage. How old are you to be a dead end? So, pastors, if you hear and hearken, that is why I say, at least there should be first love churches here, and the young people, we should see you at the Mountain of the Lord camp in Ghana.
Yes.
You see, one of the killers of the American ministry is the gradual exclusion of the rest of the world to your lives. Yes. Gradual, with good reasons, exclusion of yourself from the rest of the world, which makes you myopic, which makes you narrow-minded with a tunnel vision. You see here and you see here. Glaucoma. Your visual fields are going. You are seeing just a narrow stretch. Yes. Are you listening to me?
Yes.
You see, there is no camera that can capture what a human eye sees. The human eye is so wide. There's no camera. So when you see a wide shot like that, it is here, 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 and they join it all. I was once in Bunky's office and I asked how they took it, and they told me how many 80-something shots together to get that picture. Yeah. When you have glaucoma, glaucoma takes away the whiteness of what you can see. I don't know if there's an eye specialist here. Is there any eye specialist here? But silently, you see less, 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 and it goes. Not how far or how clearly, but the fields. How wide. And it's silent. That's what goes. Until you are just seeing something small before you. Yes. That's glaucoma, high pressure inside the eye. And when you stay only in North America, you develop spiritual glaucoma. And the whiteness of the fields reduces until you see something small. You don't know much. There are many places without a Walmart. What are the shops you have here? Macy's and Staples and what? Walmart and... You buy your thing at Agbogboloshi Market, or you find your thing at a Shell shop or Total petrol station. Yes, roadside mall. There are people selling by your cars. 95% of the world doesn't have what you are having here in America. You are just having something small. Something very few people have. You can't relate with most people. And you see, when you do that, your fields, your harvest field, it's not only your visual field, but harvest field narrows. You know, in Ghana, we have a tribe, the Ewes. They are nice people. All my best friends have been Ewes, even up till today. But they have a tendency, and in Lighthouse, we have the same tendency to stay to ourselves, just make friends with our own people, and not add others. Now, one day I went to a church of a pastor who was an Ewe, and then more Ewes come into the church. More! Everybody is Elom or Edem in the church. But then I realized that he was making a strong effort to fight that thing. Wow. Yeah. If he had a tree person, he would feel the person. If people were coming, I was standing one and people came, they tried to talk with him in Ewe, and he would speak in another language back to them, not speak Ewe. Because he realized something, that if you allow a certain closed field to establish itself, you can't reach many people. And if you are only going to reach Airways, it will be small. It will not go far. So I noticed that he was fighting that thing because he didn't want his ministry to be limited. Yeah. He's the only tribe which have a church just of their tribe. They have their own Methodist, their own Presbyterian, their own of everything. No other tribe. You don't understand the message I'm preaching. I don't care if you don't understand. You don't want to understand it. Yeah. You see, when you reduce your ability to reach others, that's why I said, as I've come here, I don't see other nationalities. I don't see a diverse picture. It's like it's a limited field. There are a lot of people in Toronto. There are a lot of people in Canada. But you have, even there may be 2 million. But for you, the only outreachable group are 200. Out of which you've got 4. And that is all. Yes. You reduce your fields of harvest. And that is why the first love, children, must be separate so that they have their own churches and are allowed to also reach out to other nationalities who all speak in the same way. Because you see, we have even courses here for accent reduction courses to reduce your accent. Accent reduction. Because it's too strong. When you speak it, we see that you are from far. Where are the two girls who were sitting here? They've moved to the young people. They are smiling now. They are smiling. Yeah. If we are going to take the land, there's going to be the rise of nation-like churches. Broad-based churches. Churches which accept others. Yes, because in a nation, you see, to be a president, if I was a president, even as a pastor, if I was a president, I would accept Muslims. I would accept, because they are all members of the nation. I would accept every religion, because it's a nation. I have to accept different types of people, because you cannot exclude people in a nation. So when you have only one group of people, it's not a thick accent. Who need accent reduction courses? You are not going to have a large group. And a nation is not a fellowship. It's not a club. A nation is a nation. He said they will rebuke nations. Nations shall flow into it. Nation-like churches. Nation-like churches are multicultural. Multinational, amen. Multicolored, amen. Multi-accent, amen. Nation-like churches. I hope you are getting what I'm saying. Yeah. And so unless the first love are released so that the young people stand on their own. Because you see, the young people here, when an older person like myself speaks, they are even making fun of our accents. And saying to themselves, this man needs accent reduction course. He needs an accent reduction course. Your mouth like I need an accent reduction. You also need an accent reduction course. Whose accent to reduce? Who yours to also reduce? Your face.
Your mouth like an accent.
Amen. Amen. Are you there or you are leaving? Yes. So if we are to take the nations, yes, and go to the cities, we need nation-like churches. Nation-like churches. And that is why the first love must be released. Hallelujah. And the pastors have to not be technological dead ends and spiritual dead ends where no technology or knowledge can be applied to you to bring an increased output.
Teaching.
pastors.
Do you have nation-like churches? Pastor Joseph and Pastor Isaac. Do you have nation-like churches? How long more? How many more years before your churches can be called nation-like churches? If you don't even believe what I'm saying, that in the last days, the mountain of the Lord's house shall be established in the top of the mountains. If you don't even believe it, how can you go for it? When I went to the First Love Church, we're just about 200 or 300 people. When they all came together. And I said, we should have at least 1,000 people in the church. We made a banner, a big banner, and printed it, 1,000 children of God. And I took the whole church to a camp. And I explained to them why we must have 1,000 people. Practically. We did outreach. We did everything. And by God's grace, we crossed 1,000, 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, and 5,000. Physical, not members. Members, we have our 26,000. But the attendance, yes. The people that have registered in their place, there are over 26,000 people. Yes, that's our members. But attendance, yes, Sunday morning physical, sitting. Chairs. And now we are aiming for 10,000 attendance. So, nation-like churches don't just drop from the sky. But it comes from the pastor who has a burning vision and will work towards it. Just as you are working towards becoming a millionaire, you can work towards having a big church. Yes. And you don't have to be full-time to do that. So we are looking for lay pastors who have that vision and that burning vision. That's why you see, when Dr. Go was describing his daughter crying at the door and wondering what has happened, somebody stolen her phone. Nobody has stolen her phone. What has happened is that the bus of members she was bringing was not full. The burning vision is not there in the pastors. Zechariah, chapter 8. Verse 20. Thus says the Lord of hosts, it shall come to pass that there shall come people and the inhabitants of many cities. Huh? There shall come people and the inhabitants of many cities. And the inhabitants of one city shall go to another, saying, let us go speedily to pray before the Lord and to seek the Lord of hosts. I will go also. Verse 22. Yea, many people and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem. And to pray before the Lord. Many people and strong nations shall come. You see, the Bible says we have come to Mount Zion, to the heavenly Jerusalem, to the blood of sprinkling, to an innumerable company of angels. That's where we have come. So when you see Jerusalem in the Old Testament, you see that. When you see Jerusalem in the Old Testament, you read it,
We are in a spiritual version of Jerusalem, the heavenly Jerusalem. When you see the word Zion, it says we have come to Zion, the heavenly Jerusalem. These are spiritual addresses. That's why the Bible says where Jesus was crucified, which is spiritually called Sodom and Egypt. These are the spiritual addresses. So where Jesus was crucified, spiritually, the address and the name of the city is Sodom and Egypt. So when we talk about Zion or Jerusalem, it's a spiritual address. Even in Israel, when we go and you ask anybody, where is Mount Zion? They can't show you. It's a vague area. And there are so many little hills. Because Jerusalem is right on top of the hill. And just outside the old walls of Jerusalem, it's a steep incline. You know, it goes down and then levels out. So it was good because in those days when you fight, well, you have to attack physically. And it's not good to attack somebody above you. Or he just push you back. You see. So that's why it says, Mount Zion, beautiful for situation. It was a beautiful situation, a beautiful location. That's why David really wanted that place. Yeah. So these are spiritual addresses. So it says, many people and strong nations shall come to seek the Lord of hosts in Jerusalem and to pray before the Lord. Verse 23. Thus saith the Lord of hosts, in those days it shall come to pass that 10 men shall take hold out of all languages of the nations. And even shall take hold of the skirt of him that is a Jew, saying, we will go with you, for we have heard that God is with you. We will go with you because we have heard that God is with you. We have heard that God is with you. Nation-like churches, where strong nations, people with different languages, coming together and saying, we will go with you. For we have heard that God is with you. So if we are to achieve the vision of tools, the vision of 20,000 churches, 20,000 pastors, 2,000 church buildings, 200 bishops, and so on, Toronto and Canada have to play their part and join in the building of nation-like churches. Have to join in. And you all have to play your part. And you have to rise up and stop being dead ends. See, a dead end is a place where there's nothing to add to it. There's nothing you can say to it. There's nothing you can push into it that will change anything about it. Yes. And that's why sometimes I don't go to places. Because if I go there, whatever I say, they won't do it. Whatever I preach, they will never obey. They will not believe it. So you don't go there because it has become a dead end. A technological and spiritual dead end. God forbid that you ever be a technological and spiritual dead end. Nation-like churches. Nation-like churches. Nation-like churches are coming out of Canada. Amen. Hallelujah. Number two, Isaiah chapter 60, the rise of nation-like people. Amen. Isaiah 60 verse 22. A little one shall become a thousand.
Amen.
And a small one a strong nation.
Hallelujah.
I the Lord will hasten it in his time.
Wow.
Yes.
Wow.
A little one,
wow,
shall become a thousand.
Yes.
A little one, a small one, shall become a strong nation.
Yes.
The rise of nation-like people will bring in the reality of the vision of taking the cities and the land for Jesus Christ. Yes. Nation-like people. One small person. A small one will become a nation. That's why I say, don't hinder the little children from becoming preachers and having their church services and coming to Mountain of the Lord and coming to do whatever and singing their songs and do whatever they can do. Because a little one will become a thousand. A small one will become a nation. The Lord will hasten it in his time. Yes. You see, God is in the business of taking people whom you may never think will amount to anything. Yeah. You know, we are going to Jamaica by the grace of God to go and dedicate their cathedral. But you see, the pastor there, Pastor David, when he was in the university, he was not even made a chief elder. So he was not a chief elder. He was nobody. A little one became a thousand. A small one became a strong nation. You see, people may not regard you, but you'll be surprised at what and who you can become in the Lord. Yes. I'm always surprised when people know me. I said, "Why do you know me, sir?" They said, "You know you're on television." But I said, "I'm not on television. Why do you say?" "Don't say you saw me on television. I'm not on the television." A little one became a nation. Yes. That is why, as I've come to Calgary, I came just for a meeting. Yes. But as I've come for a meeting, it's a nation. It's a nation-like church. Yes. I will see people. Yes. Because I've become like a nation. Nation-like people. Nation-like people.
Awesome.
Nation-like people. Are you one of the nation-like people?
Yes!
Are you one of the nation-like people?
Yes!
Nation-like churches. Nation-like people are coming out of Canada.
Yes!
So you see, today, you may not think much of, Canada. But you'll be surprised that this is where God can choose. That he's going to raise up someone who is like a nation. And my mother-in-law, you see, she's a teacher. And she has a saying that you can never tell what a student is going to become. Because you can't see it in them when you are talking to them. You'll be surprised that, I was teaching the head of state. I was teaching the president. I was doing this. You never know what a person is going to become.
Amen.
Are you there?
Yes.
Jeremiah 30.
Preach.
Verse 19. Jeremiah 30. Verse 19. Beautiful. Now, and he says, these are all prophecies for Israel which are prophecies for us. I told you we are a spiritual address. Yes. The spiritual address. And out of them shall proceed thanksgiving. Thanksgiving is going to come out of you. You say, oh God, thank you for choosing us in Canada. Thank you for blessing us. Thank you for raising up our sons. Thank you for choosing my son. Thank you for choosing my daughter. Thank you for choosing my family. Thank you for choosing me. Thank you. That's what you'll be saying. And thanksgiving shall proceed out of them. Jeremiah 30, please. And the voice of them that make merry. Nation-like people. Nation-like churches. And I will multiply them. I will multiply them. I will multiply them. You see, growth is from God. Even secular people who write books about business, some of them acknowledge and they say, you know, there's a great element of chance and luck for somebody to be successful. Yes. Great element. But they don't know that it's God. So they say luck and chance. Your mouth like luck and chance. And says, and I will multiply them and they shall not be few. It shall not be few. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Yeah. Hallelujah. Yeah. I will multiply them and they shall not be few. And I will also glorify them. That means that God will make you beautiful and they shall not be small. This is your destiny. This is your destiny. You know, our pastor in Italy, we have a pastor in Italy. He's doing great things. Yeah, he's a lay person. He has never been full-time for even a day. I remember a camp meeting in Switzerland. He came for the camp meeting. And I remember him standing there, young man. Said, oh, he's so-and-so. And they told me about him. And that he wants to start a church in Italy. We didn't have a church there. I said, oh. And they told me. So I said, okay, I'll appoint you. So I appointed him as a pastor right there. I've appointed people at all places. I've appointed people in restaurants, churches. I mean, by the roadside, I appoint you as a pastor. Straight. Yeah. It's an appointment. And I appointed him as a pastor. Prayed for him, I think, at the camp meeting. And I said, go, you are blessed. When we had a camp meeting, we had hundreds of people. And we gave them a target, I think 1,000 for the camp meeting, not the members. Camp meeting attendance, 1,000 just in Italy. And you see him all over Milan, here. More, lay pastor. No, he has never been full-time for just a day. So those of you lay pastors with 20 and 20, if you were in Italy, you would see the stories you'd be saying. How Italy doesn't work. Italy's like this. The people, they are all refugees. They are like this. And you should see even giving to the crusade. They gave. Oh. You see, a small one become 1,000. Small one. A small one. Is it not, Dr. Ogo, were you at that camp meeting? Yes, beautiful. And I saw them. I said, no. That's why I went to Italy. Because you don't go to a place which is a dead end. Yes. A small one shall become 1,000. Small one, a strong nation. Little one, 1,000. I remember him. A little one. He's become 1,000. You will become 1,000 too. And you can become 1,000 too. guys listening to what I'm saying? Back to Jeremiah. Out of them shall proceed thanksgiving, and the voice of them that make merry. And I will multiply them, and they shall not be few. And I will also glorify them, and they shall not be small. Verse 20. Their children also, their children what? Also shall be as aforetime, and their congregation shall be established before me. Nation-like people, nation-like churches. The congregation shall be established before me, and I will punish all that oppress thee. Wow. Children. Are you children listening?
Yes.
There is a great prophecy over you.
Amen.
God is going to use you.
Amen.
God is going to surprise you.
Amen.
God is going to anoint you.
Amen.
A little one will become a thousand.
Amen.
A small one will become a strong nation.
Amen.
You who have been discounted will be used by God. Verse 21. And their nobles shall be of themselves, and their governor shall proceed from the midst of them. You see, God is going to raise up important people, business people, millionaires, shall be of themselves, like right out of their own midst. These nobles will come, and these governors from themselves, because I thought they were just governed with about outsiders. If you come to Ghana, you see many of the nobles are not from Ghana. They are from Lebanon, they are from India, they are from China, they are from Europe. The owners of all the biggest things are all foreigners. But this one says, they are nobles. So within the church, the nobles will be right from our midst. The millionaires. Mashilo Atalma Abora Andelemeke. One of my church members was sending me some messages. I said, where are you? He said, I'm in a private jet. Yes. You see, my children, I remember pastoring them under trees. Now some of them are in private jets. Yes. In the same members, more boys and girls. Kayimbo, Rando. Their nobles shall be of themselves, not imported nobles. Homegrown vegetables. Their nobles shall be of themselves, and their governor shall proceed out of their midst. Put it back there. 21. And I will cause him to draw near, and he shall approach unto me. Now notice. For who is this? I say, nation-like people. Who is this that has engaged his heart to approach unto me? Who is this brother who has engaged his heart? Who has really taken his heart to follow the Lord? Huh? Who is this that has engaged his heart to approach unto me? No more excuses of Canada. You see, Canada is like this. Canada is like... I hope I mentioned the word Canada. Is it the right way? Canada. Is it, does it work? Canada. I don't know whether I'm saying the right thing. I'm not going for no access reduction, no cost, no way. Canada. Huh. You need a reduction cost. You need an accent reduction. I don't need no accent reduction cost. Canada. Canada.
Who is this who has engaged his hand to approach unto me? You see, nation-like people are going to rise. Put my verse back, please. Nobles, don't let me say put it back again. Nobles shall be of themselves. Governors shall proceed from the midst of them. So, nation-like millionaires. And it's beginning to happen. Because this is an era of the nation-like churches. Anytime God will raise up a man of God, he will raise people to support the person. It's part of the calling. Always. I've never lacked support. Yes. I've never lacked support. Yes. By the grace of God. I've never lacked support. Who is this that has engaged his heart to approach unto me, saith the Lord? Their nobles shall be of themselves. Governors will come from their midst. So all these people are going to be raised up right here in the church. Nation-like churches. Nation-like people. Who is this that has engaged his heart to approach unto me? Hallelujah.
Amen.
Are you listening to these wonderful things that are being said? Yes. So, elements of the invasion. These are the things that are going to be part of it. Number three. The rise of teaching priests. The rise of nation-like churches. The rise of nation-like people. And number three, the rise of teaching priests. 2 Chronicles 15. And look at verse 3. Amen.
Amen.
Beautiful. Now, for a long season, Israel had been without the true God. And without a teaching priest. Israel had been without the true God and without a teaching priest. For a long time. Nation-like churches. Successful invasions of cities and nations always comes with the rise of teaching priests.
Teaching.
Like myself, I'm a teaching priest. That's why we have a nation-like church. But God is going to raise up more teaching priests from here. More. Verse 4. But when they in their trouble did turn unto the Lord God of Israel and sought him, he was found of them. You see, trouble is supposed to make you turn to God. Don't forget, trouble is supposed to do what? Make you turn to God. Don't accept trouble
just for trouble's sake. Let it, the Bible says, let patience have her perfect work. Count it all joy when you go through various trials and temptations. For the working of your, for the testing of your faith works patience. But let patience have her perfect work, or let it have the right effect. When there is a problem, let it have the right effect, because it can easily not have the right effect on you and on your life. Amen. Back to, please, 2 Chronicles. Beautiful. And in those times, there was no peace to him that went out, nor to him that came in. But great vexations were upon all the inhabitants of the country. So in those times when there was no teaching priest, and there was no law, there was no peace to people that were going in and out. You see, the church is not peaceful when there's no teaching priest. That's why we teach about loyalty. People think we just talk about loyalty to fight things or to be quarrelsome. You know? We are not quarrelsome. Do we look quarrelsome? What is the quarrel? What happened? Are you quarreling? There's no quarrel here. But you see, when there is no teaching, there's no peace. And when there is teaching, it says, in those times, there was no peace to them that went out or to him that came in. There's no stability. But great vexations were upon all the inhabitants of the countries when there's no teaching priests. Verse 6. A nation was destroyed of nation, and city of city, for God did vex them all with adversity. And all this was the result of no teaching priest in the system. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
So teaching priests are people that are going to rise and do great things for God. And God is going to raise up in Canada. Is that the right way of saying it? In Canada, God is going to raise up in Canada teaching priests. Some of the girls are going to be very good teaching priests. Girls are very good pastors when they are under authority. It's dangerous for a woman not to be under authority. Yeah. They need to be under authority. If they are not under authority, it becomes a problem. Too powerful. Controlling things that they shouldn't control. Yes. First Timothy 2:14. Adam was not deceived. 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 Anywhere you see people trying to equate a woman with a man, a demon is there. You will never be a man if you are a woman. God never made us the same. You are foolish to try to make something that is not. Look, even if I take your blood, and I don't see your face, I can know whether you are a woman or a man. Even if you touch the person, you can know that it's a woman or a man. Yes. Because the constituents of your flesh are even different. The makeup of your flesh, the makeup of your blood is different. Because God made it that way. It's not something to fight. Adam was not deceived. Adam was not deceived. Adam was not deceived. Yes. Kama shapala. Anyway, back to what we are talking about. The rise of teaching priests. Your teaching anointing is coming with great strength, and God is going to use you to teach people. Are you not excited that God is going to use you as a rising teaching priest? You are going to bring understanding. You're going to bring light to people.
Amen.
People will come to church just to listen to you.
Amen.
You will explain things to them.
Amen.
Beautiful. Amen. The rise of teaching priests.
Amen.
And the scriptures will be fulfilled.
Amen.
People will say, I understood when I went into the sanctuary. Psalm 73 verse 17. I understood when I went into the sanctuary. Then I understood. Until I went into the sanctuary. Then I understood. People will say, when I come to church and I see you, then I understand. So many things that are happening. I understood when I went into the sanctuary. The rise of teaching priests.
Amen.
To bring stability.
Amen.
Sanity.
Amen.
To blast out confusion.
Amen.
By your ministry.
Amen.
By your teaching ministry.
Amen.
For a long time, Israel was without law and without a teaching priest. There was no peace for anybody. Going in, coming out. There was confusion. And then when they sought God, and God blessed them and gave them teaching priests, people to teach them. People will testify. When I came into the sanctuary and understood a lot of things. Beautiful.
Yep.
So, there's going to be a rise. And how is this rise going to come about? It's going to come about by the simple method of following to learn how to be an anointed teaching priest. Yes. You see, when there is a great person, you get it? When there's a great person whom God is using, you must always assume the truth. It's not an assumption, but it's also the fact that it's a deep well, knowing many things which he doesn't say. And maybe doesn't even know that he knows. On many occasions, more than once, God has given me visions about myself because of my own confusion. Yes. Because you get confused. When you're on earth, you are bombarded with many things. You are not sure of yourself. So there are times that God has shown me visions. One time, God gave me a vision. I was in a vision. When it's a trance, you see yourself like an actor. You are the star in the film. And you are watching. And in the film, in the video, in the vision, my stomach was opened. And it was as though my stomach had hinges. So it opened like this. And inside my stomach, I was amazed. There were no intestines. You know what was in my stomach? Cables. Three cables. Thick ones like this. Metal cables, like these shiny silver cables. Three of them. They were not touching each other. They were taut, tight cables. And there was power in the cables. Dangerous power. And it was like kind of, you see these electric high tension cables. You see this, like there's some kind of power. And the Lord suddenly closed it and said, I wanted you to see what was in you. Amen. You yourself don't know yourself. How much more somebody outside knowing you? That deep well is the well out of which is springing the ministry that we are seeing. Yes. Surviving. Surviving. Yes. Working where we don't even go. Somebody's come from Tonga Island, and it's quite important because the prince or whatever, they are going to Tonga. Yeah, these new princes, they are going there. The new ones, yeah. They are going to Tonga, and they are going to Fiji and somewhere else. Yeah, and I thought of it, wow, we have churches at where they are going. I don't know if they'll go to church. When you decide to learn and to catch the anointing, the Spirit entered into me. Ezekiel 2:2. The Spirit entered into me and He spoke to me and set me on my feet. The Spirit entered into me when He spoke to me. Many pastors have not learned how to receive the anointing, of course, and to use the anointing. You know, when you tell somebody do something and the person doesn't do it, you stop telling the person things to do. The person becomes a dead end. A technological dead end and a spiritual dead end. So when you are spoken to do this and you don't do it, no more talking. So when you hear the word and you are to implement and you don't obey it and you don't do it, there's nothing more to say to you. The old one is there. You are not interested in doing it. Yes. The anointing that God has given me is a big anointing. I'm talking in a certain way in this camp meeting. It's a big anointing. If it was not big, we would not be here. Yeah. It has to be as big, a big anointing. Otherwise, we will not be here. Yes. What we do in one segment of the ministry is what somebody is doing as his whole ministry. Yes. It's true. One little segment is somebody's whole ministry. Yes. A small one shall become a nation. A little one will become a nation. Amen. You can become a teaching priest, and I want to say to all of you, you know, somebody said, when my son started to preach, he said he came to church, he thought, you know, it's just because it's your son and so on. But when he sat there, he said he received, he was so blessed. He said, I saw that it was a real thing. Yeah. But you see, if you listen to him, the soaking in of messages and listening to preaching, because he started the church in Belgium, going up and down in a train. One day a Muslim saw him and said, I see you here every time. Where are you going? He said, I'm going to a church. And the Muslim upgraded him and said, I want to pay to upgrade you to first class on the train from London to Belgium every week for 1 year. Wow. Yes. Muslim. Yes. Yes. Teaching priests. Young boys. Soaking in messages. Telling me and quoting to me videos and messages that he's soaking in and that they are soaking in. Children. I'm telling you. You see, that's why I want to release the first love children, because they will bypass the lethargy and the backsliding of their parents. Tamalaza.
Teach and speak.
I said Tamalaza.
It's
true. Dr. Go was telling me his son. He said when his son is in the house, he has locked himself in the room and he only hears Kenneth Hagin's voice. He said, do you know that daddy listens to Kenneth Hagin? He asked his father, do you know that he listens to Kenneth Hagin? He said, that is why I'm listening to Kenneth Hagin. They are soaking in the word and becoming teaching priests as early as at the age of 19. By soaking in the messages which we have encouraged people to soak in for years. And I've not soaked in. As I am soaking in messages every day and I see the effect of it. I see the effect of it in my ministry. I study more. The same message I give you to preach, I'm studying it. Do you think I have not studied to come here? Think about it. Do you know how many notes I have? How many camps I have? I've preached over and over and over. But you are sitting here and you are experiencing fresh word. Yes, Jeremiah 15:16. Thy word was found. I found your word. Jeremiah 15:16. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my soul. Thy words were found. I found your words. Beautiful. Thy words were found. And I did eat them. And thy word was unto me. It became to be the joy and the rejoicing of my soul. That's why you are not affected by messages. Because it has not become unto you the joy and the rejoicing of your soul. It has not become something that you have eaten. Thy words were found. And I did eat them. I ate them. I didn't read them. I didn't listen to them to do an exam. I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing. The joy and the rejoicing of my soul. Because I'm called by the name of the Lord God of hosts. You see, when you are called by God, this is how you behave. He said, because I am called. by the name of the Lord God of hosts. I did eat them. The children are eating them. The children are eating them. They are singing the songs. The songs I wrote. They love them. Because you can hear when you listen to the song that it's a preaching. It's a message. It's more than a song. It's not just a melody. Yes. Thy words were found. You see, not that I was reading. It's like they were found. It was like, hey! And when I found it, I said, I did eat. I ate till I was full. And thy word became unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my soul. It was the happiest, greatest thing to me. Because I'm called by the name of the Lord God of hosts. People will be encouraged. Listen to this. Put it on. Even now, every message that has been preached on the Dag Heward-Mills video, whatever, or it's, everything is there. Every message, this, free. Thy words were found. Thy word was unto me the joy, rejoicing of my soul. People don't find it was, okay. Oh, yes. The rise of teaching priests is going to go along with Jeremiah 15:16. People who make the word the joy and the rejoicing of their soul and their hearts. That's why people are not rising up. You see, the word. You see, as I'm here, you see, I'm invited. I've been invited to Hong Kong to preach. I've been invited. These same words. I've been invited to Philippines. I've been invited to where? Sri Lanka. I've been invited to so many places. Give Thyself Holy Conference. And all these different countries. I don't even go. Most of them, I don't go. Not to tell them that I'm a doctor or to share with them physics or whatever. These words. A priest, a teaching priest is one of the highest jobs you can ever have. Amen. Far higher than anything you are doing. Far. True. Anyway, so the Spirit entered into me. You see, the power entered in me. 1988, I was in Suhum in the hospital. And I was there praying in the night, 3 a.m., on my knees. And suddenly, I was listening to the man who had been listening to Kenneth Hagin. I've been listening to him for 10 years. One day, I sat back and calculated when I started listening to Kenneth Hagin, and I realized it was 10 years. I've been listening to him for 10 years before the 1988, 78. In one night, something entered into my belly. Then I heard a voice in the room, in Suhum. The voice said, from today, you can teach. That's it, 20 million books and going. 20 million books. Yeah, that's it there. 20 million of this. Huh? Yeah. So when I found Kenneth Hagin, it was the joy and the rejoicing of my heart when I found him. When I found, I ate it and I ate him and I ate the words. There will be no teaching priest until you learn how to become a teaching priest in Canada. And people will come. You will think that, you know, that people look at me and say, but is this preaching? He's not preaching, he's just talking. Yes. And when you go even podcast, you find even in England, podcasts in England, it's only something like BBC which is higher. BBC. BBC. Yeah, download a podcast. It's only something like BBC. BBC Radio or whatever. Oh, yes. Words. Yes, from Ghana. Yeah. Podcast. Thy words were found. 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 And I did eat them. And thy word was unto me the joy and the rejoicing of my heart. Because I'm called. Because I'm called. Because God has called me. When you are called, the word will be a joy and a rejoicing to you. When you are not called, it's not a joy and rejoice. You will be sitting there yawning and tired. Snorting like a hippopotamus. Is that how you say it? Hippopotamus. Did I say it right? Hallelujah. Are you getting ready for the invasion? Are you going to become teaching priests? The rise of nation-like churches. The rise of nation-like people. The rise of teaching priests. Amen.
Amen.
Sit down. Number four. The rise of feeders. People who feed. John 21. John 21. Verse 15. John 21. Verse 15. And I will give you. So when they had dined, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he said unto them, Feed my lambs. And he said unto him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest that I love thee. And he said unto him, Feed my lambs. The rise of feeders. Amen. And he said unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he had said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. And Jesus said unto him, Feed my sheep. Ezekiel 34:23-22. Therefore will I save my flock, and they shall no more be a prey. I will judge between cattle and cattle. Verse 23. And I will set up one shepherd over them, and he shall feed them. Even my servant David, he shall feed them and he shall be their shepherd. Hallelujah.
Amen.
And I, the Lord God, will be their God, and my servant David, a prince among them. For I, the Lord, have spoken it, and I will make with them a covenant of peace. And I will cause the evil beasts to cease out of the land, and they shall dwell safely in the wilderness and sleep in the woods. Verse 27. And the tree of the field shall yield her fruit, and the earth shall yield her increase. The rise of feeding people. Now, what is the difference between a teaching priest and a feeder? Or a person who feeds? A person who feeds is someone who is concerned with the people getting what is necessary for them, even if it compromises the beauty and the order and the simplicity, and it compromises the, if you like, the greatness of the message. Yes. And sometimes the decency of the message. It's true. You love me, feed my sheep. You see, when you are feeding your children at home, you don't serve the food like the food is served in the restaurant. In the restaurant, they are more concerned with the appearance of the food on the plate. The presentation. But at home, we are concerned with, Charlie, eat all these things before I cane you. Eat the salad, eat the things you don't want. Isn't it true? Eat them. Because you are going to eat it. People are starving in Ethiopia and Eritrea. Eat it. Now, model marriage and marriage counseling is an example of feeding. You see, there is no need to say many things that are said in that book, or even a book like The Beauty and the Beast. But even let's take the model marriage. There's no need. You know, one day I took my books to a certain country whose name begins with one of the alphabets. And when I took the books, the pastor received all the books and called us back and took the model marriage out of the shop. I said, no, this book cannot be here. It's not a good book. So he took it out. And I took the book back. I said, wow, no problem. You don't want this book. Not a problem. Now, I was surprised when the pastor of that church visited me in Ghana. When he was going, he asked for something. He said, I need the book called Model Marriage. Can I get 10 copies to take? And I said, oh, but your pastor, your assistant pastor, he went and removed the book from the shop. He was not married. Oh, yes. He was not married. A bachelor. Huh? No. An elderly bachelor. An elderly bachelor. A grown-up bachelor, stricken with years. So he didn't know what is in marriage. Because in marriage, there are many things that are not palatable to say, but are necessary to make you whole. And to make you well. Yes. That is why it is one of the most widely used books. In fact, it has become almost like a standard only book around. A lot of people just use it. They shamelessly just use it in their churches. Feeders are those who will now say what is necessary, even if it's not beautiful. It's true. And there are books like that. And feedings like that. That is what binds the hearts of the people to you, because they know you are you told them the truth. It's true.
Yeah.
It may not be so fantastic. Do you think I don't have nice teachings? You think I don't have nice teachings? I have nice teachings. And many of the pastors who are older pastors, I've fed them for years. And they know I never put a lizard in their mouth before. All these years. Yes. Even the ones that they struggled to chew, when it went down and gave them vitamins, they realized that it was good that you gave us this one. Yes. It's true. Amen.
Amen.
Are you there? You are leaving?
Yes.
Yes. So it's very important that we have people who are feeders. Now, what is the effect of feeding? Feeding now leads to the giving birth of more sheep. Yes. You see, when you have just a teacher, the church will not grow. But when you have a feeder, the church will grow. You see, one day I was preaching, and an elderly lady, "Hello, Mama, give the water to this girl here. This one. You have covered yourself with this one here. To the side. You cannot pretend you are a girl when it's time to be fired. That's when you remember that you are a girl. When you are sleeping in church, you didn't remember that you are a girl. Slept and open your mouth like this. You've forgotten that you are a girl. When it's time to be pondered, you've remembered that you are a girl. How come you just remember that you are a girl? All this time you couldn't remember that you are a girl. Watch out for those who remember that they are girls at the wrong time. Listen, one day, I was feeding my church, and a lady came to church. She came one Sunday, she came next Sunday, she came next Sunday. When she came, she called me, said, "Young man, come." So I came. She said, "Look, last week I came, you were preaching about this. You got to point number 4. This week, you started from point number 1, which up to point number 4, and you only did 5. Then this week, you started again from 1, and you've gone up to 5, and you're on 6 and 7. So she said that her English words were, "Get on with it." Do what? Get on with it. You see, I'm standing and looking at my children, and I can see that they don't know point number 1. I know that they don't know point number 1. And I'm going back over my point number one. To put it into the mouth. Yes. You are telling me to get on with it. So, when you are feeding people, sometimes it compromises the beauty of the teaching. Instead of 7 points today, another 7 points next time, another 7 points next time, that's making what? 21 points. You may go over and ensure that, is it in your mouth? Did you swallow it? Drink water. You read letter, this part, and we are eating more. Take this one in. Because we are trying to put something in there, not to just have a nice presentation of a nice meal, which is not eating. It may look nice, but it's not eating. Yes. So people who are theoretical teachers, Jesus said, feed my sheep. He didn't say feed my giraffes, whose heads are very tall. So you are feeding above the heads of the ordinary people. Yes. So I look at the people and I see this one is sleeping. So my point is not entering the person. I have to make her wake up from the sleep. She cannot tell me that she's a woman or she's a girl. Hey! Are you there?
Yes.
Amen.
Amen.
Keep teaching
Amen.
Amen.
Tell somebody the rise of feeders.
The rise of feeders.
Yes. And I have enough materials for feeding. Yes. Key facts for new believers. Key facts. There's enough to feed them. Reading your Bible regularly. Hey. Your role as a church member. Develop the art of witnessing and soul winning. Grow as a new believer by fellowshipping regularly. Key facts. Grow in your life, new life, by praying regularly. 7 steps to an effective quiet time. Develop yourself by speaking in tongues. The baptism of the Holy Ghost. What you must know about water baptism. Key facts about salvation. Each one is a chapter that I've read to you. For feeding. I told them, whenever I give them in the church, I say that people don't pass their exam because they read big books. That's why I'm giving them a small book to read so that they can do well in Christ. Yes. It's a very good book. Key facts. Huh? Your role as a church member. Develop the art of witnessing and soul winning. Grow by fellowshipping regularly. Grow in your new life by praying regularly. 7 steps to an effective quiet time. Grow in your new life by reading the Bible regularly. The whole book is going to feed you and make you solid in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
a Christian and attending church, and I believed I truly loved the Lord. But there was a day I went to church, and the preacher spoke to me. He said, Jesus says, if you love me, keep my words, my commands, listen to my voice. Jesus really needs to know, how deep is your love? Is your love, how deep is your love? He really needs to know that you're willing to surrender all of your life to his will and his command. That's the least that you can do. Da 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 da. Oh, greater love hath no man than this, that a man should give his life for you. Do you love the Lord like he loves you? Do you really wanna do his will? What will you give in return for his love? Will you yield and obey, or just walk away? Jesus really needs to know, how deep is your love? Is your love, how deep is your love? He really needs to know that you're willing to surrender all of your life to his will and his command. That's the least that you can do. Da 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 da. One day Jesus turned to Peter and said, I wanna know if you really love me. Simon Peter turned to him and said, oh my Lord, why do you even ask? 'Cause you know, dear Lord, how I love you. I will keep your commands, I will feed your sheep. Jesus asking you the same, how deep is your love? Is your love, how deep is your love? He really needs to know that you're willing to surrender all of your life to his will and his command. That's the least that you can do. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. Da 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 da. If you hear his voice in your heart today, do not harden your heart, do not turn away. That's the only way you show how deep is your love, how deep is your love. He really needs to know that you're willing to surrender all of your life to his will and his command. That's the least that you can do. Da 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 da. Oh, 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 oh. How deep is your love? How deep is your love? He really needs to know that you're willing to surrender all of your life to his will and his command. That's the least that you can do. Da 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 da.
Take out your offering tonight. Take out a good offering.
before he went away, commissioned his disciples to go and teach all nations. This commission was extensive. It was an obligation for the disciples to disperse themselves to every nation, every corner of the inhabited globe, to preach to every creature without exception, without limitation. A candle in the dark, Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark, a light to the world, be a witness for my Lord. Please send me into this dark world, please use me somehow. As a candle in the dark, Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark. Many attempts at the Great Commission have been made by many Christians since the days of the first apostles, but I regret to report that the work of God has not been taken up seriously, nor has it been prosecuted with the zeal and perseverance of the early Christian church. Indeed, they were candles in the dark. Oh, be a candle in the dark, Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark. I wanna be a light to the world, be a witness for my Lord. Please send me into this dark world, please use me somehow, oh Lord, as a candle in the dark. Lord, I wanna be candle in the dark. Many people say the commission is completed by the ministry of the apostles. They say we have lots of souls in our own country. If God intends the salvation of the world, He will somehow bring the gospel to them, or bring them to the gospel. Today, most Christians sit at ease, have no concern for lost sinners. They don't want to be candles in the dark.
These are the words of William Carey.
Be a candle in the dark. Lord, I want to be a candle in the dark. A light to the world. Be a witness for my Lord. Please send me into this dark world. Please use me somehow. Oh Lord, as a candle in the dark. Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark. For the consideration of you who sit at ease, I offer these observations. If the whole body of Christians entered heartily into the Great Commission,
that's William Carey,
and loved the souls of their fellow creatures more than they loved themselves, and more than they loved their own lives, they could become candles in the dark. They could become saviors of this world. Oh yeah, candles in the dark. A light to the world. Be a witness for my Lord. Please send me into this dark world. Please use me somehow. Oh Lord, as a candle in the dark. Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark. I wanna be a candle in the dark. Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark. I wanna be a light to the world. Be a witness for my Lord. Please send me into this dark world. Use me somehow, oh Lord, as a candle in the dark. Lord, I wanna be a candle in the dark.
Wow, isn't a beautiful song? Isn't a beautiful song?
Must enter with all their hearts into the spirit of the mission. Leave all the pleasures of life behind, oh, encounter the hardships of the mission. An uncomfortable manner of living and every other inconvenience. A bit of clothing, a few essentials, ready to work as a farmer or a fisherman. This This is how to be a missionary. This is how to serve the Lord. Do you want to be a missionary? Oh,
do you want to be a missionary?
Why are you not a missionary? You too can be a missionary. What a great opportunity to be a missionary. Oh, 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 oh. Why are you not a missionary? A missionary's first business must be to learn the language of the natives. Endeavor to cultivate a friendship with them. As soon as possible, let them know the errand for which you came. Convince them that it was for their good alone, that you left all the comfort of life behind and your native country. This is how to be a missionary. This is how to serve the Lord. Do you want to be a missionary? Why are you not a missionary? You too can be a missionary. What a great opportunity, yeah, to be a missionary. Don't think highly of yourselves. Don't despise the natives. Go where God pleases. Leave relatives behind. Leave your friends behind. Leave your home behind. Stand in all readiness. To be a missionary. This is how to serve the Lord. Do you want to be a missionary? Whoa, whoa, whoa. Why are you not a missionary? You too can be a missionary. Oh, yeah. What a great opportunity to be a missionary. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Oh, 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 oh. Why are you not a missionary? Missionary, oh, this is how to serve the Lord. Do you want to be a missionary? Why are you not a missionary? I said you too can be a missionary. It's a great opportunity to be a missionary. Why are you not a missionary? This is out to be a missionary.
Hallelujah.